Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Hello and welcome to the WrestleZone podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I'm here with a little bonus, a little shorter episode, I would think, unless I start going off into tangents. We're going to talk about a recap Aberdeen Anarchy that took place this past Saturday at Deanston Community Centre. A night of big moments, big shocks, and also big matches as well, and none bigger than the main event. But we'll get on to that. Let's go through match by match what happened on the show. So we got there, sold out, Deanston Community Centre. Doors opened 5:30 for a VIP meet and greet, which was just bustling with photographs and pictures and merch all over the place. It was a nice, great atmosphere with people just able to hang out and just have a bit of a chat before the show. There was wrestlers just wandering about, so you were able to get a picture with them or get autographs and the like as well. So a lot of good stuff happened in that little bit of time before the pre-show match itself. There was a lot happening on the show in general, and I'll have a full recap and rundown of my experience at Aberdeen Anarchy in the coming weeks for our SWN podcast, Aberdeen Anarchy Road Trip. But for the show itself, we kicked off the VIP with Ted O'Keefe against Oliver Green. So Oliver Green, first time in a singles match in front of a crowd that size. Of course, he did the Training Academy, and there we go again for the, of course, the meter. He had the Training Academy show against Chris Archer, but he was coming in against Ted O'Keefe against, let's be honest, most of the tickets that were sold were VIP. So it was a big crowd in Deanston Community Centre, and Ted O'Keefe was coming back. He got the crowd riled up. He got everyone remembering why the outfit were so disliked initially in WrestleZone, and they still are. But Ted was a key factor in that, and he reminded people that the outfit aren't nice guys. And he came out and took every shortcut you could imagine making. And eventually he was able to get Oliver Green into a sharpshooter and pick up the submission victory. So it was a really good match, really, really good match. And like I say, I'll go in more depth in a little bit. But just for this recap itself, I don't want to keep you too long. I just want to tell you what happened. And like I say, you keep an eye on the social medias for WrestleZone, and they'll tell you. You can see the pictures as well from Brian Battersby and Kirsten Louise as well. There's some great pictures going on from the show. We'll have a montage again in a couple of weeks on the podcast itself. So after that, that was the pre-show. Nice little aperitif to start off the event. We got to do, there was a bit more hustle and bustle around ringside when we got onto the main show itself, with Martin Clunas dressed snappily in his pink suit, pink tartan kind of suit going on there. Didn't really get a match going on first, because the first person that came out after that was the returning Mr. P for a hero's welcome. Mr. P hadn't been seen in WrestleZone since Deanston Community Centre at Christmas Chaos in December, when it looked like he'd hung up. There was a lot of speculation, a lot of to and fro, and we didn't know at the time, but we had the inkling that Mr. P had hung up his boots or put his gloves up for one final time. And he came out at the start of the show to a hero's welcome. Everyone was roaring for Mr. P, who revealed that he is now head of WrestleZone management, a position which he held about 10 years ago, right about this time, because the first time I met Mr. P was, he was part of WrestleZone management, and I gave him my spare ticket to sell on at Aberdeen Anarchy 2013. So that's a nice little full circle moment. Mr. P started as management, went on to be a decorated wrestler in WrestleZone, becoming tag team champion with Kane Garrick, and also becoming Tri-Counties champion as well. And then he's now decided that he's going back to management, and he wants to not just control the chaos, he wants to embrace the chaos. And he is there as judge, jury, an executioner as well when it comes to WrestleZone. And for one, if there's anyone that can control, or at least try and get it through the weeds of chaos, it's definitely going to be Mr. P. And it was very excited to see him back. He was very missed that 6 months. He was very much missed in WrestleZone. He always brought a lot of action and excitement when he was hitting his head quite a lot and calling people stupid. He was confronted straight away, though, by Chris Archer coming out and pretty much just telling Mr. P that he's not gonna do what he tells him. It was a Rage Against the Machine kind of thing going for Chris Archer. So Mr. P thought about it. He knew he can't touch Chris Archer or he'll get fired. Archer can't touch Mr. P or Archer will get fired. So he just started the mosh pit match there and then. Just moved it up the card. Just changed it. Just changed the running order because that's what Mr. P does. He embraces the chaos. There was a situation there. And he just made it happen. He made the mosh pit match happen. So that's what we kicked off the main show with. The mosh pit rules. Mickey Vago and Chris Archer. And my word, there is a lot happened in this match. We got Mickey Vago brought weapons upon weapons with him. Archer had his chain in tow. There was a board used. A mosh pit board used. And there was chairs involved, of course, because you sit at a gig. If you're my age anyway, or my figure, I do like to have a seat at a show, a gig, music, or otherwise. We had massive drumsticks. I think that's the technicality of what Vago's going to call those kendo sticks, those massive ones, including a giant one. Not as big as the one that we've seen in the past with Christian Crabbe and Scotty Swift. That was gigantic, but it was up there. It was a bit more manageable. It was in that in-between kind of size. We had, what else did we have? We had beer kegs used. We had, at one point, Archer, we had cymbals used for our drum kit. And I think it was Archer's head being smashed against it repeatedly. Archer did a second rope cactus elbow drop from into the outside. There was just a lot going on. And eventually, Chris Archer found himself, at one point, found himself with going through a bin, a big bass drums, and Vago did a coast to coast, which was amazing. It was incredible to watch, and it looked like Archer was going to win. Though we had the guitar in hand, and then Mickey Vago spat that green mist in his face and rammed the guitar over Chris Archer's head to pick up the victory. I don't think this is over, but strike one goes to Mickey Vago in this match. An incredible matchup. Next up was Captain Alan Sterling. Captain Alan came out and he didn't have an opponent because, of course, Deacon Matthews was choosing his opponent. And we got the returning Evan Young. I was very excited to see Evan Young come out. We haven't seen Evan Young for quite a while. I can't actually remember off the top of my head, but it must have been around about this time last year. I remember him. He definitely wrestled at Aberdeen Anarchy in 2022. I can't remember if he was on shows after that. So he's had a good break. He came back tattooed. Attitude. He's now the captain himself. He's Captain Evan Young for that one, whether it was one night only or that's it going forward. And we're going to see some dueling captains. Evan Young came back. It was a house on fire. It's a very exciting to see Evan Young back. I'm a big fan of the young guy. Well, he's getting older now. But yeah, it was very, very weird to see Evan Young with tattoos. I was just because when we first saw him way back when he was 17, he was fresh faced and now he's like inked. A little bit. So it was like, oh my God, you definitely are older now. So great matchup. Evan Young showed a little bit of ring rust, I will say. He was just trying to get himself back into the motion in the ring, which Captain Allen, of course, he's a veteran. He took advantage of it fully and ended up rolling up Evan Young for the 3 count with his feet on the ropes as well. So a tainted win for Captain Allen. And this could be far from over whether Evan Young gets his revenge or we're still waiting. Deacon Matthews to come back. It looks like by the sounds of it, he'll be back in time for Battle of the Nations. We'll see if that's when we'll see a showdown between Captain and the Cult of Positivity. Next up, the first half main event was the WrestleZone Tag Team Championships. The 2 out of 3 falls. Foundation of the Future against the Bear City Saints. Wow. That's pretty much what we can say about this match. Wow. Two of the best teams in the country. Don't you need to argue about it? They're definitely two of the top teams in the country that are active in wrestling and around Scotland, and they proved it here. So First Blood went to Foundation of the Future. They were able to get a quick roll up on, I think it was Alex Webb, top of my head here. I could be wrong. I apologize. I'll check out our reports on the SWN website. I'm sure I'll be told otherwise. So First Blood definitely did go to Federation of the Future. Fair to say, were able to rally back and get a score tied. But eventually, it came down to just a little bit of roughness from the Foundation of the Future. It came down to Ryan and Alex. Bruiser Brad took Air Miles out to the crowd, threw him into a wall, and that gave all enough time for a pile driver to Alex Webb and the win for the Foundation of the Future. So the Foundation of the Future now, two-time WrestleZone Tag Team Champions, an incredible matchup. Not as respectful as we were possibly thinking or possibly were anticipating from the Foundation of the Future. They found their ways. They made sure to take a shortcut or two that they could find. But that's, if you're going to be a champion, you've got to find your ways to retain and regain those titles, which is what the Foundation of the Future did. It's an incredible contest. And we got the interval at that point. We were able to go around again, merch stand. I was able to pick up myself some little pins. I'm not really a pin guy, but it's quite a cool commemorative thing. Again, it reminds me to way back that first Anarchy show I went to in 2013. You got like a little goodie bag if you're a VIP, and you got a key ring and all that kind of stuff. And it was just a nice little trinket, a nice little piece of what was it? What's the word? A memento for the event. So it was nice to get those and pop them in my little box of wrestling stuff that I've got. We're also able to pick up a Granite City Road, Granite Road t-shirt. I'll show you now on the video. I've just disappeared from the video. That was terrifying. So Granite Road t-shirt here for the main event. Aspen and Caleb. That was a very weird moment. I'm not going to cut it out, though. It's okay. So we're able to pick up some merch and able to just decompress from the show itself and be able to decompress from the moments, because the matches that were given to us in that moment in time, half of the show, including the pre-show, were just fantastic. It was a great night. We were able to shout along and be able to support our favourites and be able to support just some darn good wrestling in a sold-out Danielson Community Centre. Back from the break, we got the Future Title Opportunity Ladder Match. A match I was very kind of, it felt a bit like thrown together a little bit before the show, but the match itself, phenomenal. We had everyone involved in this one. Connor Malloy eventually defeated Zach Dynamite, Dino Murphy, Tommy Raiden, and William Sterling to earn that title opportunity, and we don't know what he's going to go for. Whether it's going to be the Tri-Counties title, we'd love to see him against Zach Dynamite. Whether it's tag team titles, he gets a partner and goes against the Foundation in the Future. Whether it's the Undisputed Championship, which, you know, if you're only going to get one shot at that belt, you'll be as well go for it. But the match itself, there was so many moments where Tommy Raiden came awfully close. He came so close, he had his fingertips on the contract hanging above the ring, which so he could have vibed easily. Split second more, he would have been holding that contract. Zach Dynamite had some spills on the outside. William Sterling, unfortunately, it looks like he picked up a little bit of a injury towards the end there when he was attempting his elbow drop. He unfortunately slipped off the rope, which seemed to discombobulate him for the remaining of the match. And Dino and Murphy, they worked as a team. There wasn't any time where you thought they were going to battle out. They had a track in mind, and that track was tag team titles by the size of it, by the looks of it, anyway, from watching it. So there's a lot of moving parts to this, a lot of, like I said, thrills and spills on the outside and through ladders and on ladders, which were... There was one moment, William Sterling chokeslammed Zach Dynamite off ladder through a horizontal ladder, which was incredible, insane. And if there's someone who's picking up William Sterling's mantle of having crazy moments in ladder matches or in matches of that ilk with weapons, Zach Dynamite is certainly putting himself forward and just putting his body on the line to try and gain opportunity or gain titles or just gain bragging rights. So an incredible performance from everyone involved. Connor Malloy, though, absolute worthy winner. I look forward to seeing where he goes with that contract, whether it's going to be Battle of Nations who use it, or maybe hold on to it and just bide his time and maybe we'll see Conor Malloy as a champion at the end of the year. There's no, I don't think, I haven't seen anything to say that there's a stipulation time on that contract, so we don't know if whether he's going to hold it until Aberdeen Anarchy next year. Maybe he'll cash in on the title match and there'll be a triple threat if he hasn't won the Rumble. Who knows? That's the interesting thing about that future title opportunity. Like I say, coming into it, I thought, oh, it's a bit thrown together in as far as participants, but it possibly was one of the best matches of the night. After that, though, this was definitely interesting. Rodin King and Damien went at it, and it looks like Rodin King knocked Damien and Loopy right near the start of the match, and it changed the complexion of the performance because Damien just had to fight back at that point. He was trying his best. He was trying to stay alive. He was surviving in that particular contest. And Ronan King was doing all he could to try and get Damien to stay down for a three count. It was one of those matches where it was uncomfortable to watch at times because we were watching Damien just try to hang on. But Ronan King was relentless in his attack. I mean, Damien had his moments, but he was relentless. Ronan King was doing and trying to keep Damien down. It came to a head, though, when Damien smashed a picture frame that Ronan took to the ring. And Ronan took a shard of that glass and tried to gouge the eye of Damien, which called a halt to the contest. The referees, the crew, Mark Clunis, everyone got involved to take Damien backstage because that was a deplorable act from Ronan King. And it was one of those moments where it just... you don't know how to feel about it. It's one of those, like, you're watching it thinking is Ronan King maybe the greatest 19-year-old wrestler in the world right now, but he's deplorable in his actions with that piece of glass. And it was a scary moment in Dayton Community Center, I'm not gonna lie. But we're gonna see if there's any repercussions, because Mr. P, of course, he might be embracing the chaos, but he's got to remember his safety. But we're gonna remember the safety of the wrestlers as well, and to see Ronan try and gouge the eye of Damien with a shard of glass. There's going to be some repercussions, I'm sure, for Ronan King, because Mr. P, that falls on his head. It falls on his head, the actions of the wrestlers. As head of WrestleZone management, he's got to be the judge, jury, and the executioner in this situation. He's got to look at all the factors, but I think he's got to really call Ronan King into account for that moment, a moment that caused a stunned silence. The second time in about 6 months there's been a stunned silence in Dayton Community Center, and that was just a brutal display from Ronan King. Damien did all he could. He did all he could to hang on, but in the end, Ronan had to take an underhanded tactic to get where he to get the upper hand, to get some sort of sick revenge on Damien for embarrassing him at the Regal Rumble. Despite that, we moved on to the tag team match. We had Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed taking on Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. And this was absolutely nothing like any other match on the show. The penultimate match on the card. And it was just shenanigans. It was pure and adulterated shenanigans. Mr. WrestleZone proving that he may have been taught everything from Omar Mohammed, but he didn't quite listen to all of it, as we had Mr. WrestleZone attempting to get in the ring several times, attempting to get out of the ring more times, which didn't really end well for him. Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker didn't know what to make of it, and they seemed to be in their own kind of miscommunication world themselves. Omar Mohammed seemed to be the guy. I don't know if anyone watching, there was a bit like there's a community, there's a TV show that I enjoy watching. There's a moment where there's some multiverse stuff going on, and a character played by Donald Glover comes into the room with some pizzas, and opens the door, and there's fire, and there's just all this weird stuff happening in this room. And that's how I felt Omar was like in this particular match. He walked into this room and walked into this ring to see Rhys and Brian being wallies and just run into each other, and then turn around to see Mr. WrestleZone just confused at life as well. So it was a very he was the straight guy in the room, and he was turning around going, aye, this is just too weird, maybe. But But Mr. WrestleZone tried. He even brought down elongated tag team rope, because you know you have to hold the rope to get a tag, which referee, I think it was Dennis Law, was the referee in that particular match. He was quick to say, if it wasn't, I apologize, Mikey. He was quick to make sure that Mr. WrestleZone had to know the rules. You have to do the legal tag rope. The legal tag rope. Had to use that. But in the end, Omar Mohammed seemed to be, he had the help from Mr. WrestleZone, but a lot of the action was himself in this kind of possible little bit of a handicap match. It was like 2 against 1.5. He was able to do most of the work for Mr. WrestleZone to run in and get the pin in the end. So definitely a mood lightener after seeing Damien and Ronan in their no contest, and we got that tag team match afterwards. So it was definitely chalk and cheese when it comes to what you got there at DC Community Center for Aberdeen Anarchy. And Anarchy in a different sense of the word, I suppose. And that led us to the main event. The main event, which was Lost Boy Aspen, now announced in WrestleZone as Lost Boy Aspen, taking on the mighty Caleb Valhalla for the undisputed WrestleZone Championship. And to say this is an epic main event would be doing it a disservice. These guys just leathered each other for 15-20 minutes. They just absolutely went to town, making sure, I mean, there was, like we said in the preview, there's no animosity between these two. It's just, this is how the cards have been played. This is how the chips have lain. This is how it's ended up. We've got to see Caleb and Aspen in the main event because of Caleb's Regal Rumble win. It almost started, almost stopped before it started, with Caleb having a big high angled back suplex, which looked to rattle Aspen right off the bat. But they just kept going. The phrase has come into the wrestling vernacular over the last couple of years is big beefy men slapping meat, and this was that. This was two big guys just battering each other, just in the hopes they would get a three count. That was all that they could hope for and try to gain. And when it was all said and done, battered, bruised, just lumps of just contorted bodies, Aspen was there in the end with his hand raised. Lost by Aspen, retains the Aberdeen Anarchy and still the undisputed WrestleZone champion in an absolutely phenomenal match, which saw the members of the roster come out afterwards with ice packs, which I think was sorely needed with the amount of big shots and clubs that were happening during the match. So there's your recap of the show. It was amazing. Like I said, in a couple of weeks, we'll have a road trip episode, which will show what my journey was at Aberdeen Anarchy and how we got on. We had some predictions in the early going, and we'll see if any of them are right. Some are horrifically wrong, but we'll get to see if they're right in the future. But it was an amazing night. I will say, though, I did notice, because you know I like a bit of conspiracy theory here. In the previous show at Danston Community Centre, we saw Sean Johnson and Mr. P look like they were hanging up their boots, their gloves, their elbow pads, whatever. And in this show, it looked like after Conor Malloy won the title opportunity ladder match, William Sterling even was at the entranceway applauding and pointing to Conor Malloy. So whether that was the last out for William Sterling, I don't know. It's all speculative at this point. If it was, that's the way to go out. He tried his best. He tried his moment. His moment didn't work, and the young guys, Conor Malloy, was able to capture the opportunity, which could change his trajectory in WrestleZone. So it was if that was the last time we see William Sterling in the ring, I'd be upset. But it's a great way. It was a great match to go out on. Possibly match of the night on WrestleZone. I'm trying to think. There were so many good matches, so many great matches, so many amazing matches. But yeah, I think that ladder match possibly stole the show. But that's it. That's the recap. We'll do, as I said, a couple of weeks. We'll have a road trip episode. You can see how I got to Aberdeen Anarchy and what have you. I'll answer some of your questions on that show as well. But thank you for watching this recap. It's a little bit of a shorter episode, like I say, of Aberdeen Anarchy, a WrestleZone podcast. We'll just have to keep an eye out and find out. We should find out this week on what's happening about Battle of the Nations. And in the meantime, it's gala season. So go to a gala in Aberdeenshire, you'll probably see some WrestleZone action. But I've been Billy Strachan. Go check out WrestleZone on all the social media, Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube, everywhere. Wrestle Scotland, I think the website, wrestlescotland.co.uk. And just go and enjoy some wrestling. Have a good one.